Hello, welcome everyone. Excited to see you all here on this rainy Wednesday evening. Welcome. We're going to give everybody a couple of minutes to join us. Wonderful. Happy to see you all here. Wonderful. Hello. Welcome. We'll just give one more minute or so. People are still rolling in to the webinar with us. Wonderful to see you all here. Hello. Lots of people still joining. Yay, this is wonderful. Happy to get to spend our Wednesday together. All right. Still have a few people joining, looks like. Okay. Why don't we go ahead and get started? Again, really appreciate you being here with us. My name's Rebecca Ramsey. I'm the Executive Director of Swan Valley Connections. Swan Valley Connections is a collaborative conservation and education nonprofit organization that's located right in the heart of the Swan Valley between Missoula and Glacier National Park, roughly. And we are nestled right in the center, between the Mission Mountains Wilderness Complex and the first tribal wilderness in the nation there, and the world-famous Bob Marshall Wilderness Complex. And we aim at Swan Valley Connections to connect people to the natural world. And our mission is to inspire conservation and expand stewardship of the Swan Valley. And we connect people to the natural world through all sorts of programs with landowners. We provide visitor services for the Swan Valley area. We work with property owners for all sorts of different conservation programs, from wildlife coexistence to forest health and fire safety and wetlands and riparian restoration. And we provide educational opportunities for people of all ages, such as this monthly online program, which we hope will be going back to in person and online this summer. But for now, we're online together via Zoom, and we're grateful for that technology. And if you'd like to support this or any of our programs and learn more about what we do, you can go to www.swanvalleyconnections.org and get on our mailing list, or just search around, see what we do, sign up for some classes like Master Naturalist or Animal Track and Sign. And we also provide college programs, experiential programs. So if you've got some college kids out there, send them our way as well. But tonight we are super excited to host Beth Mendelsohn from the Owl Research Institute, who's going to be talking all about owls of Montana. And we are going to hold our questions till the end, but you can type questions anytime throughout Beth's program. If you go down to the bottom of your screen, you'll see a little icon that says Q&A. Just type your questions there. And at the end of the program, Beth will be able to answer all of your questions. And I'm sure that this program is going to inspire a lot of curiosity. So again, type your questions in the Q&A. We'll catch them at the end. Really want to thank everyone for being here with us on this Wednesday. And without further ado, Beth Mendelsohn, who is an owl researcher and field biologist with the Owl Research Institute. Take it away, Beth. Thanks so much.
Okay, thank you everyone for coming. It's really nice to see all the interest in owls out there, and we're really glad to get this opportunity to connect with more of you, whether you're local to Montana or wherever you are. So welcome. My name is Beth, and I've been working for the Owl Research Institute based out of Charlo, Montana for a few years now as a field biologist. And the Owl Research Institute is a small organization. There's just a few of us. It was founded by Denver Holt. Many of you may have heard of him. And he's been doing owl research for 40 years and founded the Owl Research Institute in Montana about 35 years ago. We are dedicated to boots on the ground owl research. So we do a lot of field work. We also do educational programs and outreach, and we are dedicated to conservation. So those are our three main missions as an organization. And Montana is a wonderful place to be researching owls because we have so many species of owls in this great state. So we're really lucky to be researching owls here where we are. And I'm going to help you guys kind of learn a little bit more about the species that you might find in Montana, where you're going to find them, how to ID them, and hopefully make them a little bit less elusive so that you'll be able to go out on your own with a little more confidence to find and ID some of these awesome species that we don't always get to see that often. So here's a little map I like to share of Montana. We call Montana the owl state because there are 15 different species of owls that you can find in Montana, which is more than any other state. Only 14 of those species breed here, and one is a winter visitor. And we have all these different kinds of habitat and vegetation in Montana that allow it to be home to so many different species. So the first step that I like to talk about when it comes to identification of owls is habitat. So getting to know what habitat you're in or what habitat you need to be in to find the species that you're looking for. And that includes the distribution across the state of where your owl might be located and the habitat in which it resides. The next thing that we'll learn about is going to be vocalization. So owls, as many of you probably know, are often active at night when you can't really see them. So you're going to be relying on hearing owls. And then we'll talk about their appearance and some basic ID tips. And then the fourth thing that's really important is the behavior of the owl. So what it's doing will help you get clues on what type of owl it is. The first habitat we're going to look at, I'm calling open country. That basically means any kind of expanses of grasslands. This photo comes from the Mission Valley, so on the west side of the Mission Mountains, which are in the background here, and has lots of different grasslands. So we have the opportunity to work on federal, state, tribal, private grasslands, which is really neat because it's home to a lot of different species of owls. I'm going to go through these open country species just to name them real quick and start to picture them in their natural habitat where you might find them. So the first one, we have the great horned owl, the barn owl, the long-eared owl, the burrowing owl, the snowy owl, and the short-eared owl. So these are all the species that we associate with those open country, grasslands, agricultural lands, tundra, prairies, things like that. Okay, so volume on here. We're gonna listen to the first species vocalization. Just listen for a few seconds and then we'll figure out what kind of owl it is. And if you guys are having trouble hearing the call, just maybe type it in and I can see what I can do to turn it up. Okay, so we're hearing a single hoot. It's a sort of a lower pitched, softer hoot that's repeated with a long spacing in between it. That is the long-eared owl. And although long-eared owls do nest and roost within thick vegetation and forest edges, they spend most of their hunting behavior in open meadows. So that's why we consider them an open country species, because they'll be out hunting at night in the grasslands. So first thing, habitat, open country, you might see a long-eared owl there, and then you're looking for thick vegetation like hawthorns or evergreen trees on the edge of a meadow where an owl can hide and camouflage itself in there. The vocalization we just heard is a great one to listen to at night. You won't really hear long-eared owls vocalizing during the day. They are very nocturnal, so it's rare to see a long-eared owl out during the day. And if you do, it's likely, you know, there's something wrong. The owl's probably extra hungry and needs to get in that hunting because they really do prefer the cover of night for hunting. Some other interesting behavioral traits about the long-eared owl that can help you find and identify them, besides being nocturnal, they roost in thick vegetation in groups. So we call them communal roosters, and that means in groups of two or more. So we've seen commonly groups of 2 to 10 owls, but we've actually seen up to 50, 60, 70 owls can be in one small area in a communal roost that they all share. And these roosts tend to be used year after year. They may move a little bit and the owls within the roosts change, but they select for the same type of sites that have good cover and camouflage to blend in. So the appearance of the long-eared owl, looking at this owl, first thing I notice is the ear tufts, which can stand up very erect or be flat. Generally, when you see the owl, they go into what I call stick pose, which is basically a camouflage pose, trying to blend in, you don't see me. So the owl puts its ear tufts up. It usually will turn sideways a little bit and get really long and narrow to blend in with its surroundings and not move. And that's just a defensive mechanism to blend in with the surroundings. So you have camouflage coloration that goes along with that. We have the barred chest, we have the brown facial disc and barred feathers as well. Another great clue when you're identifying an owl that you've been able to see perched is eye color. So long-eared owls, yellow eye and bill color, black bill. So we have the ear tufts, the yellow eyes, and the black bill. As you can see from this map over here, long-eared owls can be found throughout Montana. So that's another good clue when you're looking for owls. Look at their range or their distribution map, and that will help you figure out what may occur in your area. So at ORI, we've been doing research on long-eared owls for quite some time, for over 35 years, and that involves year-round research, finding winter roosts and finding nests, and then we're banding the owls that are located, that we locate. So it's a mark recapture study. And these photos are just showing some of the methods that we use to access nests, putting a ladder up or climbing a tree to band the chicks before they can fly. So over those 35 years, ORI has located 262 nests, banded 2,120 individuals, 726 of which were nestlings, and recaptured 880 birds. And that is the largest study of its kind on the species. And the recapture rate is really what I want you to look at here. That's really important because all we do is band the birds with a regular metal bird band. So it's really non-invasive. And with that data, we're able to recapture the bird and find out where the birds are moving, if they have nest site fidelity, dispersal, things like that. So over the years, we've collected lots of great information on that. And this is Steve Hiro here. He's been involved in that for about 25 years as well. One thing using that data that we've been able to look at is some long-term trends. So as you can see on this graph, there's a lot of ups and downs, a lot of fluctuation in numbers. And these are nesting numbers that we found within our study area starting from 1987 through 2021 of last year. And so this is where we really like to emphasize long-term studies. because owl populations tend to fluctuate, as do their prey populations, small mammals that they prey on. So we see a lot of highs and lows. And it can take many, many years to start to tease out whether or not there might be an increase or a decrease or anything concerning or patterns in the population trends. So here we have 35 years of data that's showing a slight decrease in the number of long-eared owl nests, which is interesting to look at because say like we had just taken a snapshot of this data over the past, say 6 years, what we would see there would be a drastic increase because we had the highest year ever in 2020. But with all the ups and downs, the more years we have, the better we can start to see is the population declining. And what we're concluding is that it does seem like the populations are dropping. And that's what is kind of the general consensus among researchers is that long-eared owls and the other open country species are all declining across the board. So we're gonna continue to look at that and monitor nests when we can. And what we do at this point with nest monitoring is we just find the nests, we check on them every once in a while, and we band the chicks. And so it's really a non-invasive way to keep collecting this data. We've also made a lot of other cool discoveries about long-eared owls over the years. In the bottom left-hand picture here, you can see two different long-eared owls side by side. The lighter colored one is the male and the darker colored one is the female. And Denver and Matt and some other biologists were able to figure out through behavioral observations and then genetic studies that the males are generally lighter in color and the females are darker. And they developed a method where we can sex the birds in hand and it's accurate over 95% of the time. So that's pretty cool. This picture here where there's all these branches is a photo of a communal roost. So you can count 1, 2, 3 owls that are in that photo. And there could be, you know, like I said, 10, 20, lots of owls all roosting there together. And we also keep track of the number in roosts year after year and the locations of the roosts. We've also done studies on the stress induced by capture, looking at the hormonal levels and concluding that it is a stressful event for the owls to be captured, but their hormones, it's kind of a natural stress response and they soon go back to their natural wild behaviors after capture. Okay, next species, we're ready to listen to the next one. Okay, if you have any guesses, feel free to type that into the chat or just, you know, you can guess yourself too, but that one is one that you don't get to hear that call too often. It happens rarely during the breeding season. And it's the short-eared owl. So that's our second most common open country species that we're gonna talk about today. And looking at their range map there, the purple map in the upper right-hand corner, again, they're found throughout the state in their appropriate habitat, which is grasslands. And we found that grasses about a foot high tend to be their preferred habitat, but we do find them in shorter and taller grasses as well. So the vocalization you heard, that's the male hooting, and they also do an alarm bark. Sometimes it sounds like almost like a little dog barking. And sometimes you'll hear that if you're out in their habitat walking around the field and you flush one or you get near their nest. So their behavior is a little bit different than long-eared owls. You often see short-eared owls out during the daytime, usually in the dawn and dusk hours when there's low light is when they like to do a lot of their hunting. Their flight is very distinctive as well. We call it moth-like flight with the long wings and a very buoyant lift to their flight. They have long and broad wings. Short-eared owls, unlike long-eared owls, roost on the ground. And they're also communal roosters. So you can find roosts on the ground of two, and we've seen up to 50 owls all in a very small area roosting on the ground. And then they also nest on the ground, whereas long-eared owls nest in trees as well. So the short-eared owls, again, they're an open country species. They are likely declining at a pretty fast rate. They are pretty vulnerable given that they roost and nest on the ground. Lots of predators have access to them, and the grassland habitat that they rely on is often declining or threatened. So looking at the short-eared owl, what we usually see is a round head at the top, or maybe small ear tufts that they can stick up. So much shorter than the long-eared owl ear tufts. They have the yellow eye again and the black bill, and they have a streaked front. When in flight, you can often see these little commas on the wing and a light color underneath. Here's a photo of a nest with one egg in it. Probably the owl just started laying the eggs, and they're very well concealed in the grass. So at ORI, we're doing a lot of short-eared owl research as well, and we do that year round. These photos are from the spring when we're nest searching. One really cool thing about short-eared owls is that they rely on their camouflage for defense. So if you have an owl roosting or nesting on the ground, they often don't flush or fly away until they're very, very close to them. So they would rather just sit tight and blend in and hope that you go by rather than fly and give away their location and potentially put themselves in danger. So that makes them really hard to find and study some of the time. These people in the photo have a long rope, and they're dragging the rope through the grassland to find the nest. So we spend a lot of the spring doing that, walking transects back and forth. And then if there's a roosting or a nesting owl, it'll flush when the rope gets to it, and then we can go find their nest. And for winter roost monitoring, we do a similar technique. We just don't need to use the rope. So one thing that we've seen in the past few years that is very concerning to us regarding short-eared owls is that their nests are often failing. And we don't have as many years of data on short-eared owls as we do on long-eared owls, but we are noticing that a good majority of the nests often fail, which means either the female abandons or some predator gets to the nest and eats the eggs or the chicks. So this is one of our priorities this summer, is trying to figure out what is going on, why are the nests failing at such a high rate. And so we're monitoring that with cameras and trying to do that in a non-invasive way as possible. But short-eared owls are known to be nomadic, so they move around depending on where there's good food or nesting locations. And so we're not entirely sure what the populations look like as far as, is there any genetic differentiation? Are they moving all far enough and dispersing and nesting in different areas? Or are there distinct populations? So we're going to start looking at that through a genetics study. So we'll be collecting blood from any of the birds that we catch, and we're collaborating with some other researchers around the country and around the world to start trying to learn a little bit more about their genetic population structure, whether their population is healthy genetically or if some of these declines and nest predation events are actually contributing to maybe low genetic diversity or inbreeding or low population numbers. Okay, next owl. So this is one that it does not breed in the state, so it is very unlikely that you will hear this in Montana. Any guesses? That was the snowy owl. So if you're lucky in Montana, you might get a chance to see one of these wintering here. And there's some years where you get a lot and some years where you don't get as many. And that's a bit of a different topic that I won't go into tonight. But let's just look at the range map, which shows blue, meaning that it's they only come here in the winter and only occasionally. So ID points on these guys is a good one if it's an open country, agricultural, winter. They like to roost on the ground or on low objects. Sometimes they're even seen roosting on buildings like this one on the ridge line of a house, on rock piles, things like that. And as far as appearance, they do kind of stand out because they're mostly white. And they vary from being bright, vibrant white of an adult male to a barred juvenile, which actually has a lot of dark markings on it, and a female, which is somewhere in between. So they're white to some degree, and some are bright white, and some have less white. They all have the yellow eyes as well, the dark bill, and the rounded head. So again, we're looking at those same ID points to ID these owls, the behavior, roosting on the ground, hunting in the evenings, and coming down only in the winter. Okay, next owl. This is a fun one. Okay, I see one. Somebody got it. Burrowing owl. Good. So burrowing owls, we actually don't at the Owl Institute have a study going on burrowing owls right now, mostly because they don't occur in our valley. And as you can see from the range map, they only summer here and only in the eastern portion of the state, not in the western portion of the state. And for their habitat, again, grasslands, open country, and they also require burrows for nesting. So you'd have to have some kind of ground dwelling, like ground squirrels or badgers, something like that, because they take over those nests and use the nest. So that's what you're looking for in their habitat. Their vocalization is that cuckoo sound. And they're often walking around on the ground or using low perches. I have those really long legs. So we have, for appearance, the rounded head, yellow eye with a yellow bill and long legs. And if you see them on the ground and you're wondering, maybe it could be a short-eared owl, the burrowing owl is probably about half the size of the short-eared owl and has those longer legs. Next owl. I like to describe this one as nails on a chalkboard. I've also heard a metal rake dragged across cement. So kind of an unpleasant, scary. Looks like people are getting it. Barn owl. Nice. So there we have the barn owl. You can see from the range, they do occur throughout Montana, but they are usually a little bit more uncommon here. They roost and nest in barns often, but they can also nest in any kind of cavity, like in the side of a cliff, things like that. But people often see them in agricultural areas where they find old barns to nest in. You often will see like a flash of white when it's a barn owl. They do have a pretty light appearance, much smaller than a snowy owl. But for example, they'll perch on fence posts, fly across the road. When you drive by, you'll just kind of see a flash of white. And they're very distinctive as far as their appearance, and their facial disc is a heart-shaped. So it's like a longer face than all the other owls that occur in North America. And they have the long legs again, the light bill, and the dark eyes. Okay, so real quick, we're gonna just review the open country species that we have gone through. Barn owl, long-eared owl, burrowing owl, short-eared owl, and snowy owl. And then I have the great horned owl in here as well. And you're gonna start noticing that the great horned owl is gonna show up And we'll go over that one a little bit later. So our next habitat that I'd like to talk about is forest. So there's a lot of species of owl in Montana that occur mainly in forested areas. The saw-whet owl, the northern hawk owl, the flammulated owl, the northern pygmy owl, the boreal owl, the great gray owl, and of course the great horned owl again. So we'll start with one of my favorites. So I'm just going to say real quick, if you ever hear this anywhere in the state of Montana, call me, please, right away. We'd love to hear about it. That is the great gray. Good guesses. The great gray. And we're working on finding more about nests of great grays in Montana. So we're putting a lot of effort the past few years into doing surveys to detect nesting areas of great gray owls. So they are very difficult to find. Their hoot is pretty low. It's not as loud as like a great horned owl, and their territories are large, and they're often in boreal forest habitat. So a little more difficult to find, and we would really like to learn more about their habitat requirements for nesting and the specific characteristics of the nest sites that they choose so that we can better conserve and find those areas for them. So the great gray owl in Montana only occurs on the western side of the state where there's some boreal forest. They are usually in, like to hunt in wetter areas, like kind of boggy, marshy areas in forests and meadows within forests. They can use small forest openings up to larger meadows as well. And they require some old growth generally for nesting because they do like to nest on old broken trees called snakes. So fairly distinctive owl, you might confuse it with a few other species like a great horned or a barred owl, but they have the facial disc with the concentric circles and the little bow tie here, which really can stand out sometimes in low light right under the bill at the bottom of the facial disc where you have those white markings, yellow eyes, yellow bill, and really just gray mottled color throughout. As far as time of day, the great grays can often be seen hunting and becoming active at dusk. So you would look on the edges of meadows and hunting areas as they come out of their roosts in the deep forest where you'd find them during the day, to the edges of meadows where you'll find them at the dusk and hunting at night. So definitely look for wetter areas. They specialize mostly on voles and pocket gophers. The fledgling here you can see in the bottom right corner. Actually, it's probably not flying yet. A chick just out of the nest. And I put that photo in because it's another habitat characteristic, these fallen down trees. So that's important because the chicks don't fly. When they come out of the nest, they need to be able to climb up to safety and get high up in the trees so that they can avoid predators. And so areas of forest that have really been cleared and don't have a lot of fallen down trees, fallen logs, leaning trees, branches are not going to be great habitat for the great gray. Okay, next species. Sometimes we get calls from people wondering why there's a truck backing up in their driveway all night long, and we say, aha, saw-whet owl. Nice. Looks like a lot of you got that. So the northern saw-whet owl is generally considered a forest-dwelling species as well, and kind of like we talked about with a few of the other species, long-eared, short-eared, their defense mechanism is generally to be concealed and stay still. So in this photo on the left, you'll find them in these roosts where there's dense vegetation. They can be in conifers or they can be in shrubbery where there's a bit of cover and they can't be seen too well. And then they'll just sit there and hide there during the day. And they generally don't come out until nighttime when it's pretty dark to start hunting. For breeding season, sawettes also rely on cavities in trees. So the aspen that you're seeing here with the female poking out, that's a nest, and it's probably made by a northern flicker or something of that sort. So breeding season habitat needs to have cavities in trees or holes where the owls can use to nest. On the map, we can see that their range is throughout Montana, but only in the winter are they in the northeastern part of the state, and then they're in the southwestern part of the state year round. So at ORI, we actually get to study their migration and their breeding. And we have a migration station in Missoula, just south of Missoula, that's been running for 10 years now. And we've banded 1,250 migrating sawit owls and recaptured 40 of those birds. And that's a combination of birds that we've banded and recaptured or birds that other banding stations have banded and then we've recaptured. And that data is really neat to help us understand their migration routes and their migration behaviors, because some of the owls that we capture seem to breed here and winter here, and some appear to be migrants. So what I have here in this bar chart is the timing of migration that we've seen in our area right here. And this can vary all across the country. And what we see is a peak usually in the migration around the first or second week of October. But throughout the fall, we have a pretty good sawit migration coming through here. Okay, next species. Okay, somebody got it. Small owl, close. Okay, I like that. It is a small owl. It's the northern pygmy owl. And it sounds pretty similar to the sawit, I think, to some people. And my biggest piece of advice on determining the call between a pygmy and a sawit is what time of day is it? Because pygmies are actually not nocturnal. They're usually active diurnally and crepuscularly, so throughout the day and at dawn and dusk is kind of the peak of their activity. So the pygmy owls will actually usually start calling right around dawn, and they'll call again right before sunset. So that's a good clue. If you're hearing that toot noise in the forest and it's during the day, you're probably looking for a northern pygmy owl. And these guys are tiny, so they're really about the size of a robin or even smaller, so they can really blend into their surroundings. And so their range is similar to some of the other forest owls in the western part of Montana, where there's coniferous forest. They can also be in deciduous forest. And again, they require cavities for nesting. So anywhere where there's natural cavities or woodpecker holes, basically. So any areas where you can find that, you'll probably find northern pygmy owls nesting. And given that they are active during the day, they tend to feed more on birds too. And so about half and half between birds and small mammals and other creatures for their diet. When you're looking at a pygmy owl, you're usually seeing a rounded head, bright yellow eyes, and a lighter colored bill with that streaked chest and a really small narrow tail. At ORI, we've been doing pygmy owl research for quite a number of years too, and that's headed up by Steve Hiro, who does it fully on a volunteer basis. And he's documented 46 nests in the past, I think 25 years. And so this is just showing us what kind of tree species they're utilizing in our area for nesting. And the most common is aspen and larch and cottonwood. And those are the trees that you most often find cavities in. So they really prefer that mixed habitat where you're going to have larch or aspen or mixed in. Okay, next owl. This owl, I've been told, is one of the most common owls in the country. Yet you never see it. Any guesses? Got that double deep hoot. This is the flammulated owl. So a little surprising that they may be a little more common than we think, just very well concealed. ORI has done some research on flammulated owls and found some nest sites in Montana. They're difficult to find. Again, they rely on these cavities and they tend to prefer a more open yet older growth forest. And you can see on the range map, we have a green area in western Montana. That's because flammulated owls are only here during the breeding season or during the summer because they feed on insects. So as the fall and winter starts to come in and the weather gets colder, the flammulated owls leave because they can't survive for the winter without their food source. Okay, next species. Okay, somebody got that one again too. Boreal owl. The boreal owl is another small owl, a little bit bigger than the pygmy or the saulet. And like their name suggests, they are in boreal forests. And they tend to be at higher elevations. And again, they rely on cavities. And this one is in a nest box that ORI has been monitoring. And so they can use natural cavities in trees or nest boxes, as can some of the other cavity nesting owls. So the boreal owl call is probably one of the best ways to locate a boreal owl because their call is pretty loud, distinctive, and it really does carry. So if you're ever in a more higher elevation boreal forest area and you hear that, that's a really good sign that you have boreal owls around. Okay, I think we have one more forest owl here. Okay, I don't see any guesses on that one. That one is the northern hawk owl. And so in Montana here, this little purple range on the map is mostly the area around Glacier National Park, and that's their only known breeding range in Montana. So pretty localized there. They have been spotted in the winter in other areas of the state, but as far as breeding, it's mostly the areas around Glacier. And again, they're a cavity nesting owl. So they do rely on larger cavities, and you're usually gonna find boreal owls in areas that have been burned, like this one here that's perched on a burned out snag that has a nesting cavity within it. It's delivering prey to its chick, which is the other photo there. So if you're ever in Glacier National Park and find yourself in one of these old burn areas, definitely look around and listen for the northern hawk owl. They're kind of a medium to small sized owl with a really long tail. They have that distinctive facial disc with the yellow eye and light bill. Okay, so one more habitat that I kind of separated out here from the open country and the forest owls. And this is like a riparian. And so that again is a type of forest habitat, but some of these species are commonly found in areas that are near water. So we have the barred owl, the western screech owl, the eastern screech owl, and the great horned owl. So in total now, we have named 15 different species of owl, and there will be a quiz afterwards if you can name all 15 species. So we'll listen to the first one. I think some of you guys will probably get this one. Barred, so it goes, who cooks for you? Who cooks for you all? A lot of people have got that one, okay. So barred owls are relatively newer to Montana. They've expanded their range westward, and so they are occurring in the western part of the state now, breeding and year round. And they are usually in pretty dense forests, often near water. A barred owl might look a little like a great horned or a little like a great gray, but if you look closely, you'll see those big dark brown eyes that look almost like black, and the yellow bill with that round head and facial disc, and then a barred front. So the barred owl, you might see, you'll definitely hear it. They're generally active and hooting at night when it's pretty dark, and less often during the day. Okay. Got some guesses coming in close. Yeah, so that is the western screech, and I like to call it the bouncy ball call. It kind of sounds like that, the ball bouncing, I guess, faster and faster. So in Montana, we have the western screech. We also have the eastern screech, and really the best way to tell those two apart is by their call. So the eastern screech sounds a little different. And again, the range is a good way to tell those two species apart as well, because the western screech actually only occurs west of the continental divide, and the eastern screech tends to stay east of the divide. So that's another clue that can help you. But again, they're cavity nesting owls. You'll often find them in larger cavities in cottonwoods, along river bottoms, and riparian areas where there are large older growth trees. They nest in the cavities, and unlike a lot of the other cavity nesting owls, they will sometimes roost in cavities as well. So you may see them in tree cavities in the winter as well. The western screech owl has the yellow eyes, the dark bill, ear tufts, and a really concealment camouflage coloration. The eastern screech can come in two different color phases. The red rusty color is a little less common than the gray, which looks very similar to the western screech. It has the yellow eyes, a little bit lighter bill, and again, that camouflage plumage. Okay, so we've gone over 15 species of owls that you may see in Montana and learned kind of how to identify them. The most important step, I would say, is being habitat and location. Are you within their range? And what habitat are you in? So the first thing you can think about is, what owls might I see here? Or if you're looking for a specific owl, learn to go to where those owls have their appropriate habitat. Then we can start looking at time of day, things like that, and behavior. What is the owl doing? Where is it perched? What is it hunting? What does the nest look like? Things like that. And then obviously you can also look at their appearance. If you're lucky enough to get a good look at the owl perched and sitting still, shape of the head, ear tufts are round, eye color, bill color, and then body color and plumage characteristics. And then the last thing is the vocalizations, which is really one of the best way to find and identify owls, is their distinct and unique vocalizations. So when you're out there looking for owls, a lot of the times they're concealed, they're camoed, they're hidden. It is really difficult to find them. And so what we like to do is look for owl sign. And in this photo, what you're seeing is a nice pile of pellets and whitewash in the snow. I think this is from a long-eared owl roost. So when you have communal roosts or even a single owl using the same roost for a whole day or multiple days or weeks, you end up with the poop and the pellets on the ground. All the owls cast pellets, so they swallow their prey and then they can't digest the feathers and the bones and the fur. So all that comes up in a nice pellet. And if you find a pellet, you know that there's been an owl around. And then the whitewash, so their poop is kind of this white, chalky, almost off-white buffy color, not bright white like some birds. And again, under their roost or down the side of the tree or the pole where they were hunting and roosting, you might get to see that. And then find an owl nearby or know that you're in the territory of an owl and you can come back and look around and find the owl. Finding feathers on the ground is also sometimes a great clue that there's owls around. Owl feathers or other feathers from other birds that the owls have killed and eaten. So there's a couple ways we can go about looking for owls. We can look for them when they're sleeping or roosting, which for most owls is during the day, which is when we're usually awake and can see. So that's one way to do it. Or you can look for owls at night when you're really using your ears to listen for the owls. And another way to find owls is a search for their nests. If you know when the owl will be breeding, which starts basically now in Montana, the great horned owls have laid eggs in most cases, and then extends all the way really into May and June, you can find the nests. Really interesting fact about owls is that they do not make their own nests. So, and I think most of these species that we've gone through, we've talked a little bit about what their nests might look like. So we have the cavity nesting owls, like on the right here. That's a pileated woodpecker hole that was used by a northern saw-whet owl as a nest. In the middle here, that is an old stick nest, probably from a raven or something like that, that is actually being occupied by a barn owl. And then on the left, we have an old broken off tree. It's called a snag that's kind of worn out in the middle. There's actually a great gray owl nesting on top of that. So those are a few types of nests. There's stick nests. Many of the owls will just take over a nest from another bird. The long-eared owl nest that we looked at, those are often magpie nests or old nests from hawks. And great horned owls, we can see those in a variety of different nests. Snags, cliffs, platforms, stick nests, large tree cavities. There are, I would say, two species of owl that we went over that do kind of build their own nests. The first one is the snowy owl, which only nests in the Arctic tundra, and they nest on the ground and they just scrape a little bit of a cup on top of a mound, if you could call that nest building. And then the owl that nests in Montana, the short-eared owl on the ground, they sort of clear a little area and put some grass down, but it's very minimal and it ends up kind of lined with feathers, but it's really not considered building a nest, but they do make their own space to nest. So when you're saying, is that an owl nest? Well, the only way to really tell is if there's an owl in it. So you can always go back and check during the breeding season to find out if there's an owl in the cavity that you found or an owl in the stick nest or the snag that you found. While I'm here talking about nests, I do want to mention kind of ethical birding and photography, especially of nests. Like we talked about, these sites can be very sensitive. Some of these species are declining, possibly at rapid rates. And we've seen dramatic fluctuations in their populations. So in a year that they do have the opportunity to nest because the prey numbers are good, we really need to make sure we are giving them that opportunity and not providing even more hardship for them. So bothering a nest, meaning extensively viewing it, getting too close to it, preventing the male from hunting, flushing the female off the nest where she needs to incubate eggs, brood chicks, or protect and feed chicks are all behaviors that we really need to avoid doing if we are going to care about and conserve these owls. So I do encourage people to go out and look for nests and find nests and then give them their space, you know, observe once a week from a distance with a scope or binoculars to see how those owls are doing. Okay, so we're gonna put some of the skills we just learned to the test. We're gonna play a little game called Can You Find and ID the Owl? So usually we do this in person and people can kind of stand up and say, but we have the chat here. So you can either just say it to yourself or you're welcome to type in the chat when you see the owl and ID it. Ready, set, go. Okay, great gray, there it is. All right, nice. Great gray owl, right there, blending in. You'll see that all the time with great grays. They can really camo it right up on the log. That's funny, right up on the trunk of the tree. Okay, we have three more. Ready, go. I see one guess. Nope, three wrong guesses. Okay, I'm gonna point to the owl. Can you guys see my cursor? The owl's there. Let's look at the habitat. I'm seeing some open forest that's been burned. Hawk owl, yes, okay, somebody got it. So there's a hawk owl right there. Okay, next one. Okay, so that one's a little easier there. You can see hiding in the grass is a short-eared owl. And you can imagine that it's pretty easy to walk right by that and not see it at all. So I don't know how somebody got that photo, but pretty amazing how they can conceal themselves in the grass on a nest. Okay, last one. Easy one. Okay, screech. I see a couple of people guessing long-eared. It does have those ear tufts. And his eyes are closed, so a little tougher, but it's the screech owl. Nice. Okay, so hopefully you guys all learned a little bit about how to find and ID those owls. One question I just wanted to mention, I've been getting this question a lot, is do male and female owls look different? Like, can you tell in the field? And like I talked about with long-eared owls, with practice, you can ID those in the field. Short-eared owls can have different color, male versus female. Barn owls, but all owls have sexual dimorphism in regards to their size. So in this photo, the more brownish, larger owl is the female and the lighter one is the male. So if you actually see a pair of owls perched together and one looks bigger, it's generally going to be the female. So kind of cool fact to know is that size difference. And in these, in the great horned owls, there are different variations in colors that are not related to their sex. Okay, well, thank you very much for listening. I really appreciate the chance to get to present to this audience and teach you guys about owls, because I love owls and I'm super passionate about them and wanting to share how to find them and how to ID them. I have the Owl Research Institute's webpage on here, owlresearchinstitute.org, and we have a lot of great resources on there for you to learn more about owls, learn more about what we do, and make a donation if you'd like to support our on-the-ground owl research, conservation, and education efforts. And I think we're going to open it up to questions now.
Beth, that was amazing. Thank you so much. I learned so much. You should see, I've got just pages of notes. And there are lots of questions that we will try to get to. So for everyone who's on, I just want to say first that this program has been recorded and we will get it posted to our YouTube and our website soon, so you can watch this again, share with your friends and family, etc. So many great factoids, and I feel like, you know, owls have captured the imagination of people, you know, for throughout the ages, right? And how amazing that we have so many in Montana. One question is, how do you capture the birds in order to put the bands on them? It sounds like you know you have lots of different species you're studying, from the migrating ones, you know, to the ones in the grass. So tell us, how do you capture these little guys?
Yeah, well, that would be a whole different seminar, I think. But honestly, using kind of what you learned today, so learning about their habitat and behavior and utilizing those factors to set up different kinds of traps. So every owl is a little bit different on how we can capture them and when. For example, the solid migration that I was talking about, we use what's called an audio lure. So we just play the vocalization of the owl on repeat. And the idea is that we know there's owls migrating by and we draw them in towards that lure, and we have a mist net set up, which is a pretty gentle net that's used often for catching different kinds of birds. Mm-hmm. On a lot of the owls, we'll use live bait of some kind. So learn about what their prey is. For example, a mouse, and put that into a trap design so we can lure the owl in and catch it that way. And there's a few owls that we actually can catch passively, meaning we don't need to use any kind of lure or bait, but we can utilize their habitat and their flight to capture them. So different kinds of traps, nets, and lures depending on the species.
Neat. And you had mentioned cameras, and so are you using essentially like game trail style camera traps?
That's for the short eards, I think.
I think that was the one you were talking about, the grass.
Yeah, so that's something new that we're starting this year, and it's a little more complicated than we were hoping. We're working with some pretty cool and experienced photographers to set up a game camera type trap in the grass that we can leave and set up, and it will capture the nest. So if anything happens at the nest, like a raven coming in or just the female leaving the nest, we'll get to document that without ever having to go to the nest, without disturbing it ourselves. So we can at least take out that factor while still learning about what is happening to the nest. So we are still working on that. We're still looking for funding to get those cameras and get it all set up. And hopefully we'll have that all figured out by the time they start nesting in late April.
That's brilliant. I'm so looking forward to talking to you offline about partnership opportunities and also about the amount of great grays we have in the swan. We'll discuss.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great.
So let's see, there early in the presentation, when you were going through the grassland species, you had talked about, you know, the kind of the steady decline in the short-eared owls, for instance, and kind of across the board of those grassland species. Can you talk a little bit about the decline? Why you suspect they're declining?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, grassland birds in general, pretty much across the board, are mostly declining at a higher rate than other habitats. So mostly that is because grassland habitats are threatened and declining. It's hard to find the kind of habitat that owls need, which is like a large contiguous grasslands. For example, the short-eared owls, they're nomadic. They move around a lot so they can utilize different areas, but they do need a wide expanse of those areas so they can wander around until they find high enough prey densities to nest. And like we saw, the prey populations fluctuate as do the owl populations. So a lot of reasons with short-eared owls locally here, what we're seeing is some habitat management may be having effects, like weed control, grazing, burning, things like that. We don't know if those are going to have long-term negative or positive effects yet. Agriculture, for sure, grazing and cattle is definitely taking some of the habitat away. And then also just cultivating crops where there could have been grasslands. Yeah, those are some of the biggest ones. And then a possible change in the predator dynamics, like increases in raven nests and increases in some of the ground mesoc predators like skunks, raccoons, things like that.
Interesting. Yeah, gosh, endless research that you could be doing. That was another question, was if pesticides and herbicides could be affecting the nesting. Another question was wondering, with the burrowing owl using a badger's burrow, for instance, is that risky behavior? Do they ever, you know, are they preyed upon by badgers, for instance?
Yeah, you know, I don't know too much about that. I don't have any experience with that, so I hesitate to answer that question. Usually they do choose a burrow that's abandoned, but if they didn't, then I can imagine, yes, that would be a problem. Yeah.
Another question is, can you help maybe talk about what sources of education for someone who may want to study owls? Can you talk a little bit about what's the path to get to be an owl researcher?
Yeah, you know, I would love to talk about that because I had no idea that this was a thing that a person could do until much later in life. Growing up in the Midwest, you know, I love nature and animals, but field research on birds wasn't really something that I was exposed to until later. So, you know, my first advice is to volunteer. Just connect with any local researchers in your area that are doing the kind of research you're interested in, whether that's owls or other kinds of birds or wildlife in general, to just get out and find volunteer opportunities. And we're always looking for committed, interesting people. And, you know, if you do have some time to volunteer, that's really the best way to get involved and then eventually work your way up and even get hired or go back to school. And, you know, doing a degree in wildlife biology and focusing on owls would be another way to do that. Awesome. Yeah, there's lots of opportunities. There's not a lot of funding, so it can be slim pickings out there. But if you're passionate and interested, there's lots of research that needs to be done.
That's really neat. Let's see. So there was a question about the great horned owl. Did you happen to have a vocalization of the great horned owl, or did
did I not play one? Yeah, I think so.
That's great. We there was a couple in a row of folks saying, I think we might have missed that one.
This is a duet, male and female.
Neat. That's so neat. And I know their size difference is significant, it seems, between the male and female.
That's yep, great. Can be.
Mm-hmm. So let's talk about cavity nests for a moment. How high up typically are those cavity nests? Like, would you be able to see it with the naked eye?
Oh, yeah, that varies a lot. We've had pygmy and sawit nests from maybe 6 feet or even lower off the ground all the way up to 60. 70 feet. I would say they're going to average more like 25, 30. So high enough that it would be tough to get up to without a really, really tall ladder. But yeah, they can be anywhere. That's something we're looking at, is the height as well as the tree species diameter, and then the actual dimensions of the cavity itself, the opening and the interior dimensions.
Interesting. We have a 7-year-old who would like to know, could you see a snowy owl in Bozeman?
Yeah, you could. If you're looking for specific wheres and hows, I do not know, but I'm sure you could contact some local birders or organizations in the Bozeman area who could probably point you towards some good areas to look. It's getting a little bit later in the season now, so next winter might be a better bet.
Awesome. Okay, great. And so there was a question about volunteering. So just contact Owl Research Institute if you're interested in volunteering, have the time, dedication. That's great.
Yep. We have contact information on the webpage. You can email is usually the best way. We're not often in the office to answer calls, and we'll let you know what opportunities we have.
Awesome. Question about great gray owls. About the interaction between owls. Do great horned owls ever prey on great gray owls? Specifically was the question.
Yeah, they can. The chicks, usually, like the great horned owls, can sometimes prey on the great gray owl chicks. Their nesting areas can overlap a little bit. I've seen them fight over nesting areas, and the great gray, although it is considered the largest owl as far as its wingspan and its height, its feet are a little bit smaller and it weighs a lot less than the great horn. So a great horn can usually kind of win in a fight, I guess. The other advantage that great horns have, being that they are larger and have larger feet and talons, is that they can prey on a bunch of different things, whereas great grays tend to stick to small mammals. Great horns, small mammals, you know, rabbits, ducks, pheasants, all sorts of things. So yes, sometimes they will, but I would not consider that to be like one of the main predators of great grays. You know, most of these owls are kind of near the top of the food chain and don't have a ton of predators on the adults, especially. It's usually the young that are vulnerable.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense. Somebody had asked about, said that they have an owl box at their place, at their cabin here in the Condon area. And they're wondering, how can you attract owls to actually use a nesting box?
Yeah, I don't know maybe what species they're looking at. But using some of the information we talked about and then going a little bit deeper, and depending on what kind of owl you're trying to attract, what kind of prey they might need. And that's usually going to be small mammals. So you're going to need to leave some habitat on your property or wherever the nest box is for small mammals. So taller grasses, brush piles, wetter areas, you know, leaf litter, things like that are going to help. You know, the owls need something to eat nearby.
That makes such great sense. That's just a great opportunity. Well, it's interesting, you know, a lot of what I'm hearing is habitat for lots of other animals too. You know, if you essentially are kind of stewarding your place, and in our case in the forest, you know, if you're taking good care of your forest, it seems like you'll be providing good habitat for owls too.
Yeah. And there's some good advice on, I think it's called nestwatch.org, about constructing nest boxes, the dimensions to use, and then like what kind of habitat to choose, how high in the tree or where to put them, things like that too.
That's great. Thank you for that resource.
Yep. And I see somebody just mentioned in the chat, don't use poison either. So that's a good point for a small mammal habitat. You know, if you're poisoning small mammals, you're poisoning the owls too. So
yeah, absolutely. That's a good point. Somebody else had asked about lead too. Do you ever, you didn't mention any of them as being you know, scavenging like an eagle would, and you know, that's certainly something that obviously they find in eagles quite a bit is lead poisoning. Do you ever see that in owls?
No, I haven't seen that. A lot of owl species do occasionally scavenge during the winter. Great horns especially, you'll see them scavenging on carcasses, but we've also seen snowies, saw-whets, barn owls, different species who may scavenge occasionally. It's probably not a main food source. And in general, they're probably not ingesting as large of a quantities as something like maybe a bald eagle would. So I think there's probably a bit of a barrier there to getting lead poisoning. I would look a little bit more at a lead shot, say from shooting ground squirrels or something near where great horned owls are located. I haven't seen any studies on that, but I can imagine it's a possibility.
Mm-hmm. That's a really good point too. Another question is, what is the purpose of owl vocalizations? So can you just talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I would say most of the vocalizations we heard today are called advertising or territorial calling. So the male needs two things. He needs to attract a female and he needs to defend his territory. So he uses the vocalization to call in different females to say, hey, I'm here. I have a nesting site. Would you like to join me? And then to vocalize to other potential males in the area that's his territory. And there's so many different vocalizations that we didn't hear today. All the owls have multiple calls that mean different things, which can be really fun to look at. I would say if you're interested in the vocalizations, the next thing to learn would probably be the fledgling begging calls. You'll hear those later in the spring. And they usually sound like some kind of loud screech and can be a really good clue to finding an owl nest. And then there's different kind of defensive calls that are good to learn as well, which might mean like if you're approaching an owl that you're getting too close and they're feeling threatened and doing a defensive bark or hoot or scream or whoop.
Do you have good resources for that? Is it Cornell University where you can go and hear the, and be able to like click on the different species and hear their calls?
Yeah, they have a lot of calls on there. It can be difficult to find some of the more obscure calls. You can also look on a website called Xenocanto, which has, I think, different users can just upload calls that they've recorded. So there's a lot to go through, but you'll find more regional specific and different vocalizations on there.
Neat. Someone had asked about, are there someone from Canada? We've got an international audience tonight, asking if we had regulations about pesticides or poisons being used in various habitats. I don't think that there really are any regulations that we have. Do you know of that?
Yeah, not that I'm aware of that are directly affecting owls, like in any of our study areas. Some of the pesticides I was referring to are generally in managed grasslands that are managed for game birds or other species, or maybe trying to get back to a more native habitat. And then there's different pesticides that people generally use on their own property to kill weeds and things like that. So yeah, I mean, there's certain ones you can use and certain ones that you can't use, but I think as mostly they're fairly unregulated.
Mm-hmm. And then it looks like probably our last question, with the exception of, I will say again, where you can find this recording. Wondering about the lifespan of different owls. Can you talk about how long you expect them to live?
Yeah, it depends on the species, but you know, usually the larger species have a longer expected lifespan. It's tough to study. We get a lot of that information from the mark recapture studies I was talking about, like banding an owl and then getting lucky enough to catch it like 20 years later. So I think some of the oldest saw-whets, smaller owls, are about 8 to 10 years. And then some of the larger great-gray, great-horned, 10, even 20 years old.
Wow.
But generally, there's the average lifespan is much shorter than that because many of the birds die as juveniles. But once they get to that breeding age, they have a better chance of survival.
There are a couple more questions if you can, if you're still good for
Yeah,
a
okay.
couple.
A few more minutes. Yeah.
Awesome. What is your favorite owl?
Yeah, I get that question a lot. I'm going to say short-eared owl. It's kind of my new favorite. They're really tough to capture and fun to study, and I'm kind of worried about them. And I just think they're really beautiful. Followed
Neat.
by the great gray, followed by the pygmy.
Neat. That's a great selection. And what is the owl that is most common or is easiest to see that most folks are most likely to see?
Yeah, that's definitely the gray horned owl, which can occur almost anywhere, really. And they're pretty accustomed to humans. They nest in winter right around developed areas often. And their hoot is loud and they vocalize year round sometimes. And so they're pretty common and easy to hear. And still really special, though. You know, if you go out on an owl walk and are lucky enough to hear gray horned owl vocalizing, it's pretty cool.
Really neat. Kind of to follow up on that, you just said, you know, they're often seen in populated areas. Do owls ever nest in cities or developed areas, or is it exclusively kind of at the edge of development?
Yeah, they definitely can. There's a few species that more commonly do that. Gray horns, eastern screech owls, barn owls, a few species that seem a little bit better adapted to do that, or maybe they just have more overlap in habitat with developed areas.
Okay. There are a couple of questions about eggs and gestation. Can you maybe just talk a little bit generally about kind of egg? I mean, I guess it would be different for every species, but gestation and maybe a description of the eggs.
Yeah, the average incubation is about 30 days for most of the species, give or take a few days, a little longer for a great horned owl, shorter for a smaller pygmy owl, things like that. But almost all the owl species begin incubation with the first egg. So say like a short-eared owl lays an egg, immediately the female goes on the egg and starts incubating it. And then she lays another egg a day or two later and a day or two later. So you might have a period of, like we've seen 11 eggs in a short-eared owl nest. So those eggs were probably laid over the course of almost 20 days. And so they also hatch over the course of 20 days. So that can kind of extend that incubation period, whereas the first egg might have hatched. There's still a bunch more that haven't. Pygmy owls are the only owl we're aware of that does not do that. They actually don't start incubating until all eggs are laid. And so they have what's called synchronous hatching.
Fascinating. That is, like you said, any of these topics could be their own presentation to be expounded on. The last question that I'm going to give you here is, was wondering about, do you collaborate with any other researchers such as the MPG Ranch, who has a ranch here in the Swan and also down in the Bitterroot, or any other institutes?
Yeah, we do for sure collaborate with other institutions. We've worked with the MPG Ranch in the past and other owl groups across the country, really. Yeah.
Awesome. Good. Well, Beth, really can't thank you enough. This is really fabulous. Such a great, thorough, helpful, fun presentation. So I want to encourage everyone to, of course, visit the OwlResearchInstitute.org. Check them out, learn more, give them money, as well as SwanValleyConnections.org, where this video will be posted. Probably not until maybe this weekend or next week. It takes a bit for this to come through and get a bit edited. But if you would like to get on our mailing list, if you're not already, again, you can go right to swanvalleyconnections.org, get on our mailing list, and then what we do is we will email a link out once it is posted. And we don't send out a ton of emails, just when there's something cool happening, like saying, hey, that owl presentation is up on our website. We also have a YouTube channel and you'll be able to find it and a lot of other wildlife videos there. Next month, as always, on the first Wednesday of the month, we will be hosting another informational presentation on April 6th. It will be our virtual version of the Spring Bear Wake Up Social. We'll have a great presentation from grizzly bear researcher Lori Roberts and some great information about just staying safe in bear country and remembering that bears will soon be coming out of hibernation. Again, Beth, can't thank you enough for this presentation on owls. Looking forward to talking to you soon and hopefully doing a little collaboration with you ourselves. So thanks everyone for being with us tonight. Hope to see you next month as well. Have a great evening. Thanks, Beth. Thanks everyone.